Hi, I'm Natalie, and I'm going to be reading from my poetry collection, Small, and answering a few questions at the end. So big thank you to Christina and Catherine for allowing me to be part of this, and to Cardiff Met as well. Small was written as a book which characterised my experience with an eating disorder. And Small is the little demon on my shoulder that represents that. So I wanted to try and have that voice come in through a poetry collection in the same way as that voice infiltrates everything that I experience in day-to-day life, which is why these poems are interspersed between other more general ones, just to capture the process that happens in the mind of someone affected by an ED. I'm going to start off with one of the Small poems, which is Good Morning Small. Good morning Small. We all have our favourite demons. Small is born out of angles and nerves, has a brain the weight of a fingernail. Clunks into life like a terrible clock, counting the bars of her ribs. Her Latin name cracks the throat, wrecks like a dead lizard. She pins both arms like voodoo, nudges me onto the scales. The light on her clavicle hardens. She jabs, she giggles, she flounces. This stupid act splits me to ounces. The next one is one I wrote as a kind of tongue-in-cheek thing, about breakups, about how breakups are dramatic as they are, but if you're a poet, they're about 10 times more dramatic than everyone else's. Never date a poet. She says, never date a poet, they're forever bowling their souls through doorways, cowering and wanting, staggering stairs to the moon. Perhaps then you will confide in her. You've always adored poets, the brute pen, the velvet coat dropped from her back begging to be touched. The shelled knuckle trawling her spine for hours. You will ask her, is that okay? Dinner is a plate of impressionism too sad to taste. She will take a cold sip, carry your new face on a plate and write okay with her nail. Between you, Carla's sigh out tedious eternities. Water jugs forever stagnating. You say so, knowing the scrubbed red of her eye marks two hysterical months of longing. She won't bother to engage. The dull piano lulls and soothes the slow salt snows. Why do you not weep? Her naked body, a question mark, rising to meet you. Bitter cold. Out and in, small cold gods in bathrooms, cold hands, porcelain, some deeper chill wafts back, holds you close, splayed on the bathroom mat, hairs autograph the sink, nails, scar, the soap, perfume, shower mist, the vulnerable wrist dips to a drown. Why do you not weep? Every pause is the end of the world. Small crashes the party. This is just too sad for me, I say, listing every birthday she has ruined, my aging body split to photons across the therapist's desk. Each year's face thinning, fingers white against peeling vinyl. I have come to hate this plastic chair, the heart's cleft splitting as I turn back to watch myself, school uniformed at my own party, grinning idiotic, lips raining cake. Elastic string of my birthday hat splitting the pudge of my chin. There are no friends at the party. Slyly, I lick powdered sugar off my thumb, clutching an ice-wet tumbler of Diet Coke. Small sneaks in, smelling of marzipan. The room is abundant with such punishments. This next poem is one about the day I got diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, which has fed a lot into my experience with Small, and I find it the most difficult topic to write about because it's from a child's view. So I wanted this one to be quite simple in terms of language. Diagnosis, 10th of December, 1998. The doctor shows us a cartoon kid, half naked, grinning from ear to ear with all her guts on show. He points out the pancreas, a slimy cluster of grapes about this size, squeezes his fist to demonstrate, so I do the same with a tiny hand, wince as the cannula shifts. He tells me it's okay to feel confused, that it's a lot to take in, but he's talking now to my parents, trying to smile, eyes hardened to moons. I ask to go home, but there are things to do. Blood rolled to a minuscule ruby, bald at the end of my finger. Voodoo pins to master. Do you understand? We sit in silence on the drive home, hands raw and ringing. Mam's handbag trills with needles, slim vials of insulin, a parting gift. I panic about blood glucose, my sorry bones, arse bruised like a plum from the car seat. For a moment, I'm glad I don't get it. Mam smokes the shock for us through the window of Dad's Mondeo. We discuss anything but this bunch of grapes useless inside me, a bobbing goldfish flipped over. This is one which is based on the story of the Iliad. And for me, the hero in that story was not Achilles or Hector, but it was a woman, and it was Hector's wife, Andromache, who not only brought stability to the men who were at war, but also she had to watch her husband as he got dragged around around Troy, and she had to watch her own son thrown from the Trojan walls, and yet she disappears off from the story without much more of a mention. Andromache. Assume I'm wearing black. Assume I've swathed myself. In the hollow shades of his bruised knees, dust clogged and sticky, assume I am leeching away with him. The tracks of his belly scar the dirt. Does anyone ask for his wife? Hair dripping over the Trojan walls, towering 10 feet over the beetled men below, gleaming up and blinking through her. Assume the wind blew me over the edge of the wall, quiet and pale as salt. Hear me say nothing at all. See these living hands. Hear the smack of my palm against stone, blood coiling its way to my heart, binds me tough as a horseman's rope. Blow my bones to polished pipes they play when great men fall. For me, no tune at all if I should choose to stagger up, sway on broken toes, burst my lungs screaming for the dead man's bones with our only child crumbling over tumbling stone in a gasp of blood and milk. When Hector cracked his back behind the chariot, when the bruises flowered blue, when our only baby spiraled like sycamore the gods, I felt it too. I called Astyanax. I called Hector. Who called Andromache? Who? And another one where I try and twist the story and give the woman more of a voice is Romeo, taken from Juliet's perspective. These days, Juliet forgets on purpose to draw the curtains, smacks her thighs talcumed and pink, armpits still crackling with bubbles. Every night, she hoists one leg over the footstool she's dragged whispering across the carpet to the balcony window, angled just so. Lifts a whip of lotion and rubs. Each calf tightens, gleams, and Romeo, poor Romeo, circles the bushes below, waiting for a glimpse of bare ass, nubbed breasts, nipples stiffening on powdered ribs. A smudge of oil glistening on one clean shoulder. Tell them, Romeo, in 14 lines only, kill it with a couplet. Tell them all about love at first sight. I'll give you another small poem now. This is Small Takes a Bath. Small falls into bubbles, tumbling in a slow arc, skin flaking like slate, approaching the molten core of the earth. The depths of the world have a certain smell, like copper or black holes or pearls of dead glamour. Do you remember how I dug my nails in your hand, your fingers plunging like divers, steaming clear? Get out of the bath, you'd said, pulling my hair, tugging it like a plug, huge useless saviour, invisible ship, trailing rainbows in halos. There are chains down here, soapy gods, angels blooming enormously. Small rings her hair, smooth her crown. A wet skull makes a mortal of anyone. Another theme that came up in this collection was my experience in India, and even though it's been 3 years now, I still get a lot of the senses that I experienced there coming through in my poetry, and I feel like that's a sequence that's unfinished for me, and I'd love to go back and write more about it. And this one was the first poem I wrote after coming back, and it was about being back in rainy Swansea and missing it, and everything I was looking at was getting mixed up with my memories of India and the yearning for it. After India. The estopped bells, forever tilted mid-swing, fat scarves gagged around their mouths like coughing guppies. They swim politely. They scull through smoke, all bobbled cotton and business suits. Puffed mornings they don't mean, rattling their umbrellas in doorways. You settle back, dab pastry on your finger. Think, from your owl brown hat of the Sundarbans, of long white crocodiles dragging their bellies and smiling. Think of hornets, long as darts. Shake Calcutta, with your one gloved hand against the window, rub the snouts of dirty dogs with sugared thumbs. You're stinking of culture and Jean-Marie, the towie for the iron slug of the Ganges. For the boys, tugging fish like teeth or beggar's rupees. Bowl-bellied, face-streaked, a shaggy tiger of a man waves you back to Varanasi from your air-conditioned carriage, temples shoving to the heavens between the BT building and the sea. Spit sandalwood onto your wrists after India. Crease marigolds and ash into your fists. Small visits the bakery. Small does things that shrink me to a flower mite. I haven't got the energy to carry her home in a shopping bag, sharpened bones, a brain microscopic. Doesn't she know there are people starving on the streets, says a voice from the queue. Hot belly rising, a woman laughs, chewing a cloud of baguette. When she smiles, a sunflower seed pokes from her teeth like a stiffened moth, pinned between her incisors. Doesn't she know I am freezer-mist? I am thin as a pocket of cellophane. The oven smoke chokes me with comforts. Small, springboards from bread roll to bread roll, kicking flour as she goes. Gabriel. Gabriel is slumped now, rolling stars between his fingers, waiting for a cry. All night long he has stalked the hills, startled sheep, washed his wings in bitter streams, squeezed clouds with shaking hands. The labour was long. Joseph had set down his woodblocks, stood uselessly between woman and manger, patted Mary's fists. In a stable, bent like a tired horse, a saviour flings out his limbs, gasps for air, kicks miracles into straw. Kings scarper like geckos through deserts. Shepherds quake in the dark. Gabriel yanks out his trumpet, puffs its dusty note. At this sudden art, the world turns its head from the stuporous earth, lilies twisting for rain. And we're coming to the end now, so I'm just going to leave you with two more. This one is Grief. Maybe God will do something with the flaccid roses, freeze their necks, spit miracles into the jug and bring them back, little macabre thorns, fire skirts. Something naked and spectral rises from the earth, materializing like ectoplasm from a waiting room seance. A wilting acquaintance says something kind because you're gone. I am not certain of any of these things. I am biting hard on the candle, joking about smoking it like a finger-thick cigarette. I am slamming a window shut to keep out sunsets. I am peeling a lily open, splaying its early tinge. I am changing the subject to nothing. Nobody knows what to do with me. And I'll leave you with a small poem. I think the best one to finish with would probably be Small Gets Resuscitated. Curtains snatch upward in a gust of emergency. Ribs split like a binder. Someone tugs up her sleeve. There it is, more bruised than roses. Her tattoo sputters back into bloom. Slick dab, pricked vein, dry snaps of breath. The multitudinous dead trudge to her bedside, slab-toed, hunched, waiting, and snug in death bags. Feet reeking of latex and moss. Stand clear. The panicked slam of my desperate hands haul her back from the tunnel, the ribs snapped shut. A sudden myocardiogram paddles back to life, and Small is back, laughing her head off. My writing process tends to be very linked with when I wake and when I run. So my favourite time of day to write would be at 5 a.m, when you're in that haze between sleep and consciousness, and you're not quite sure what's real and what's not. That's when I'm more in tune with my subconscious. It's when I'm more in the flow and I'm not quite aware of time. It's often the case that I forget that I've even written at all until later on in the day and go back to look at it. And I find running early in the morning is my most creative time of day. It's like my sacred space for running. I always try and tap out lines into my phone as the ideas flow. And taking photos is important to me as well while I'm running, because I love seeing how the light changes that running route every single day. So no two sunrises are the same. And it's the same with writing, that getting up and writing every morning, your mood might be different in the same way that the light might be different. And you'll always get a different outcome. And this is something that I do with editing as well. In the same way that different times of day in different seasons can change how a running route looks and change the mood of a photo I've taken, looking at your poem at different times of day will completely change how it makes you feel, and you'll have a totally different idea of it depending on your mood as well. So you could have written something at 5 a.m. that you think is genius, you go back to it later on in the day and you realise, okay, there's a lot that needs to change there. And it's about bringing the two together so that you trust enough in the creative process to be able to channel your full self into it, but also you're able to go back to it later on and realise what needs to improve, rather than just saying that it's complete. So editing for me is later on in the day, and writing is earlier. And my biggest influences with writing are probably Dylan Thomas and Sylvia Plath, and they're writers that I keep returning to. And as much as I buy new poetry collections all the time, and there's certainly a lot of writers that I read in Wales, contemporary writers, it's those two that are my go-to when I need to get inspired. I'm currently reading, the latest copy of Poetry Wales has just arrived, so I'll be reading that. I'm taking a little break from reading poetry at the moment. I've read a lot of it. I've read These Queer Merboys by Serge Neptune, which was fantastic. I've read Loose Jewels by Emily Vanderplug, which is amazing. And also there was Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man by Oliver James Lomax, which I read as my grandfather was ill, and it's about his nan. And that to me is one I've returned to quite often. For now, I've moved on to Just Kids by Patti Smith, and I'm also reading Hello Friend, We Missed You, which recently won the Not the Booker Prize. And a bit of parting advice for you as young writers would be to trust yourself and trust in the creative process, because you'll have enough people who will question what you're doing and enough people who will challenge your writing, and you need to support each other and look out for yourself as well. My biggest quote that always keeps me going is, "The biggest enemy to creativity is self-doubt" by Sylvia Plath, and it's one that I've pinned above my desk to keep me going, because it is. Often it's you that's holding you back because you feel like you'll never compare. But comparing yourself to other writers is completely futile, because there's no point aiming to be a paler imitation of a writer that you admire. You're the only one that has your voice, and no one can be a better version of you. And that's the voice that we need to hear. And if you do have writer's block at any point, don't beat yourself up, because this is another thing that's happened in lockdown, is so many people have said that, "I haven't written a novel," or "I haven't written that poetry collection." Be kind to yourself, because without living, you've got nothing to write about. And know that if you do go out, or you take a walk, or you take a few weeks off, or you don't write at all for a year, be completely in the moment, and when the time is right, your talent won't leave you. Writing will be waiting for you when you're ready. And on that, good luck with your studies, and you've picked an amazing course, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it.